regular meeting of the Town of Quartzsite Common Council for Tuesday, December 11th, 2018, is now in session. Do we have a member of the audience wishing to give the invocation? Please stand.
A little bit of physics this evening. Contrast, similarity, sometimes they're indiscernible. When I think you see something that's definite a contrast, once I dig into it and start searching things out, I find there are a lot of similarities there. Likewise, for similarity, you've heard people say, well, we're driving exactly the same car, except mine is yellow and yours is green. So sometimes we can't even tell the difference. It seems to me that contrast and similarity are different ends of the same stick, and yet the stick somehow has importance. The stick represents not only what allows contrast and similarity to exist and creates the space between them, but it causes both of them to be part of a whole. May contrast and similarity work that way in this body of government and in the relationship between that government and the people it serves.
Amen.
Please join us as we honor our nation's flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will the clerk please call the roll?
Mayor Simpson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Swartz.
Present.
Councilmember Shue.
Here.
Councilmember Bearcat.
Present.
Councilmember Goldberg.
Present.
Councilmember Hager.
Present.
Our town manager is off sick tonight, won't be joining us, we'll do the best we can to try to answer questions, those that would have been directed to the town manager. Item one, call to the public, announcements and communication from citizens.
Carrie Hammond.
Thank you, Town Council. Tonight I'd like to take this opportunity to address the issues of educating the children in the town of Quartzsite. The small size of the school identifies the fact that there aren't enough parents to support the efforts of the school. The fact that the average age of Quartzsite's population is somewhere between 75 and 83 indicates that members of the general public are past the age of ably giving support. We as a town need to explore not only how to get outside interest to participate in our children's education, but how financially to achieve any meaningful help. As is said, it takes a village or a town to cooperate in the care and education of their children. This town's government has shown that it is capable of solving problems that 8 to 10 years ago seemed unsolvable. Huge strides have been made in the effort to upright this ship. In the upright and floating position, it needs outrigging to steady and support forward movement. I propose that outrigging to be our young people, who one day will be the captain and the crew of the Quartzsite town government. They need to be trained and mentored for that job. The end depends on the beginning. We know this is true in the success of Buck Connor days. Can we use that same formula to adopt a plan to facilitate the school's current efforts to move our future citizens forward? Are we able to solve another problem that looks today to be unsolvable? I say yes. Let's try.
Thank you.
Jared Mummy.
Okay, so I have a couple of questions for you all. I was looking at, through the, I think it's called the budget, not the budget, the accounts payable, and I stumbled across that we have a $1,000 internet bill where $662 of it comes from the library internet, and that internet stays on 24/7, 365, for people to sit out in our parking lot, do God knows what on their computers, for all hours of the night. My only question is, why should the public had to be forced to pay $662 that it, I'm assuming about half of that of the internet gets used after hours from when the library and the town hall closes. Why should the public be forced to pay for people's internet when there's free internet at like McDonald's or Love's or Pilot, some of these truck stops where the taxpayer isn't paying for the internet? And I personally don't think it's a great look onto the town to have four or five cars lined up in front of our town hall all hours of the night using their computers, letting their dogs run around free and stuff like that. I don't think it's a very good picture of Quartzsite that we want to portray to the outside public and to beginning visitors when they pull up to town hall meetings. Or last week we had a presentation by a gentleman about the paint rock paintings from, I forget what it's called, but there's four or five cars taking up the front of the parking lot with their dogs out on chains, letting their dogs run around, and garbage spread all over. I do not think that's a great picture for the town to portray. Thank you.
Thank you.
Shanana Rain Golden Bear.
Greetings, Mayor and Council. Shanana Rain Golden Bear. Just a couple of things. This Saturday is our Christmas light parade, and the lineup will be starting at Ironwood over by the QIA at 6 o'clock. Judging will take place before the parade, so we're encouraging all the participants to be there early so that they can be judged. And the parade starts at 7 p.m. It'll leave Mesquite Avenue and it'll head east on East Main over to Plymouth, and then it'll turn north on Plymouth, and then head east again on Quail Trail and end up at the community center, where the town is sponsoring an after party and photos with Santa Claus. So bring the kids, bring your family, dress warm. It might be a little chilly this year, but have lots of fun. And there's a couple of things happening on Main Street. A couple of the businesses are offering deals, and I think there's going to be a little campfire, some hot chocolate, and some other deals at another business. So come on out, enjoy the Christmas light parade.
What's the date on that?
Saturday, the 15th. Good question. So tomorrow, up in Parker, is the Explore La Paz County Tourism Expo. And that's going to be held at the Blue Water Casino and Resort in Parker from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Quartzsite will have a booth. There's going to be lots of booths. There's lots. If you're looking for something to do in the county, you will be able to find everything that's going on right there, all in one place. And Linda, our Council Goldberg, has been our leader in this and done an extreme amount of work to make this happen. So we encourage everyone to attend, come up and get lots of fun activities and all the services that are available in the county. That's at the Blue Water from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. tomorrow. I think that's it. Thank you.
And it's a team. It's not just me.
You're the ringleader.
Good. Okay, we'll bring the chief up here and have the chief wishes to introduce one of our new officers.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I'd like to introduce our new officer, Benjamin McKinney. He comes to us from Cachon Police Department with 3 years of service, and prior to that, he served in the United States Marine Corps for over 20 years, so he is a retired U.S. Marine and a veteran, so we're obviously proud of that. We think he's going to be a great addition to the police department. think he'll fit into the community very well. So, Benjamin McKinney, council and community.
Next, we'll have a public hearing. Public hearing on the sign code, adoption of the sign code by reference, Article 12 of the zoning articles. Conduct public hearing and consider adoption of an ordinance declaring the document entitled the 2018 Town of Portside Sign Code, dated July 24, 2018, as a public record, adopting by reference that public record known as the 2018 Town of Portside Sign Code, dated July 24, 2018, to amend the zoning articles of the Town of Portside, Arizona, as set forth herein, repealing Article 12, Sign Code, Section 1, Purposes, Section 2, Definitions, and Section 3, General, all related to the sign permit requirements, sign regulations, permitted locations of signs in zoning districts, temporary signs requirements, with special provisions related to carnival signs, non-conforming signs, abandoned signs, and enforcement of the sign code, providing for repeal of conflicting ordinances, providing for severability, and providing penalties. Okay, now, our town manager is not here. Where do you wish to start? We do have Mark Goldberg here for explanations. Hopefully he'll be able to provide, answer some of the questions, as well as Susan. Tracy also is here. So we've got plenty of people to answer questions. What's your questions?
I've got some corrections and some questions.
Surprise.
And the surprise. In the forward of the on page 2 of the code, where it says sign seasonal, and it appears in the document that I just going to vote on. It says a sign erected on or after November 1 of any year and removed no later than April 30th of the same year. My calendar, April comes before November. So how can you remove it before it's been put up?
I think it should probably say of the following year.
That would be my suggestion. Okay, so it needs to be corrected on that. And then on the code that we're going to vote on, which is also page 2. On page 17, on the recovery of costs, if the town incurs a cost and the removal of, I think it probably should be removal or repair of a sign.
I'm so glad you're there.
I don't know if it has anything to do with the enforcement once it's in effect or not. But, let me see. Now, this I don't know if Tracy or who can answer this, but on page 7, it says sign location requirements in section G of paragraph 2. It says the lowest portion of any sign which extends over an area intended for pedestrian use shall be at least 8 feet above the finished grade. But when you look at page 12, there's a diagram. And it says in this section, and maybe I'm reading it wrong, but in this section, the maximum height is 8 feet, and the sign size is 8 feet by 4 feet. That only leaves 4 feet of clearance and not 8 feet of clearance. Am I seeing that incorrectly?
That is a ground-mounted sign.
Okay, but to me there's a conflict with what it says in sign location requirements, which says in G, paragraph 2, the lowest portion of any sign which extends over an area intended for pedestrian use shall be at least 8 feet above finished grade. But you look you look in here, and it only gives you, according to what the sign, the diagram says, is there's only 4 feet that's allowed.
But the...
I just want to make sure that we don't look.
So what they're meaning for the lowest portion of any sign which extends over an area intended for pedestrian. So the ground-mounted sign is not going to be projecting over any pedestrian walkways or anything like that. That's going to be currently mounted to the ground, adjacent to a walking path.
I just want to make sure, because it wasn't clear to me, and if it's not clear to me, I'm not an architect or anything. I just want to make sure that when somebody goes out and inspects it, that we're all on the same page in the location of the sign and the height of the sign and all that.
Yep.
Because when I looked through it first, it just looked like it says 8 feet, and then in this diagram...
Okay, so on page 12, that's going to be the ground-mounted sign. So those can be a maximum of 8 feet high and 4 feet wide.
Okay.
Okay, so on page 11 is going to be the freestanding signs, which this portion of the no... at least 8 feet above the finished grade, that's going to fall into that freestanding sign.
Okay, but again, on section 4 says lower portion of any sign.
Which extends
over. Over an area intended for pedestrian use. I just want to make sure that we've got it right, that there's not going to be any confusion.
A ground mounted sign is not going to extend over an area where there's a pedestrian use.
Okay, that's fine. I just want to make sure that was a little confusing to me, and sometimes I can be dense. I just wanted to make sure I was understanding I had the right correction for it. Okay, those in that section, that's all I have.
And in that same section G, number 2, no sign shall obstruct an entrance, exit, or fire to a building.
Fire exit?
Is that what it is, fire exit? Or entrance? Or access?
Access?
Mm-hmm.
Fire
access.
Or fire.
Fire.
Fire escape? Fire.
Can't walk an access to a building where they would be able to get on the roof with a sign.
Entrance, exit, or fire. Oh, okay.
Or fire department access.
I don't know what the technical term is, but I think it's probably fire access.
That means just you have access to the fire. We want to make sure the emergency vehicles can. That's the way that I would look at it, right?
Or emergency access.
Right. Ambulance, fire, police.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
More technical.
That's good. Thank you.
So you're going to put in emergency access?
Yes.
Tracy, you had a question or something on painting?
I did, because in the IBC it states that painting is an exempt item from any tenant maintenance on anything, and I thought that that might fall under the sign code as well. But Mark brought it up that if somebody is painting a sign on a building or something, that you don't want them to paint it too large or anything like that. You want them to be able to paint the building. So they want the sign to be removed. So I can see where that comes. But I just thought if they were maintaining a sign or repainting it, I can see for a new sign, but I was just questioning any time if they were to repaint it or touch it up or anything like that.
Where are you, Tracy?
Page, I think it... Page 4, paragraph, section 3, paragraph 1, permit required. Except as provided for exempt signs, it shall be unlawful for any person to construct, install, attach, place, paint, alter, relocate, or otherwise maintain any sign in the town without obtaining, first obtaining a sign permit. So, I'm not sure if the sign code would fall under the same aspects as the IBC and not requiring one.
The IBC does not require a...
Not for painting. Painting, tiling, carpeting.
Does it cover signs? Covers structures.
It covers structures.
But if you want, just... If you want not to require a permit for just maintenance items, take that out.
Mark's the expert, so...
It says in there, or otherwise maintained, so repainting it would be a maintenance thing, I think.
That's what she's...
Well, I think the language maintain is not maintain like fix it, it's maintain like a wreck. In building codes, when you say you're going to maintain something, you're erecting it, I don't think it's meant in the sense of repainting a sign. This section, what it's dealing with is, it's talking about construct, install, attach. It's physically erecting a sign. The reason that paint's in there is when somebody comes in and they have a physical sign, a can sign or something, they're going to mount on a building, they come in and get a permit for it so that you can check the size and the structures, the electrical and so forth. The reason for checking a painted sign is so that somebody just doesn't go out there and paint the side of a building who may not have a permit to do any work in town, number one. And number two, that the sign that he's painting meets the requirements of the sign code. And unless you have a permit process where he comes in and gets a permit to paint it, then you know it's going to be properly placed, properly sized, and so forth. That's the only intent, is the proper size and placement, not maintenance. Typically in the sign code, and I think there's a section in here somewhere that says you can replace the face of an existing sign or repaint it without any permit or any other activity, because you're not changing anything, you're just maintaining it. And the intent's not to regulate maintenance of signs, the intent's to regulate new signs.
Mark, Times 3 has a mural on the site. At what point does a mural become a sign? They don't have any advertising on them, it's just the mural. So would that be exempt from the signs, painted mural on a building?
A wall sign is defined in here on the same page. It says a sign fastened to or painted on the wall of the building in such a manner that the wall becomes a supporting structure for or forms the background surface of the sign, which is not projected more than 12 inches. And then the general definition of sign is any device or structure which draws attention to an object, product, place, activity, opinion, person, organization, or business which may be viewed from private property of another or from a public street, road, highway, parking lot, or public area.
So even with no writing on it, it would still be a sign.
It's a device of visual communication designed to attract the attention of the public, and so therefore it qualifies as a sign. You say, well, there's nothing on it that says it's a restaurant or anything else, but it definitely does attract the attention of the public.
Sure.
And you could have a sign that's a mural that has things that are related to the business, which then would make it a huge sign. So by definition and by definition of a wall sign, those two things would say that anything painted on a building like that constitutes a sign.
Okay, so then artwork would be constituted as a sign?
Technically, murals are a sign and would require a permit.
So if we wanted a mural out here on the side of the town building, it would be considered a sign?
Technically, yeah. You could probably have an exemption for a decorative mural that relates to the nature of the community or something. You could probably have an exemption that covers things like that. But by having a permit process, you at least have a chance to look at it. And if you're dealing with a decorative sign of a mural type that's not really related to advertising the business, you'd really have to construct some language for the act that defines it other than just a sign. Right now, they're just kind of as a sign. There's no nuance to it. And so the size of that would be limited by the amount of signage that's permitted on the building. And it could take the place of other signage on the building where this is currently constructed. So if you want to accommodate murals and things throughout the community, we'd have to amend the code later to bring in a specific section of the rest of that.
Anyone else have questions?
Yeah, just let me understand. So I'm going back to what Star brought up about paragraph one, section eight permit required. Is it clear enough that when we say otherwise maintain, that we're not talking about maintaining maintenance of a sign?
I would say it'd probably be better, or maybe more specific, to say otherwise erect.
What if we just take out or otherwise, or otherwise maintain, just put a lot of stuff here, paint, alter, relocate any sign in town, and take out the or otherwise maintain?
That's probably a good idea. The sentence not confusing, it's very precise of what you're asking for.
I would like to see that done.
Concur.
Anyone else have questions for Mark?
Sort of back to times three. Their sign, because it takes up the whole side of their building, is it going to be out of code?
Well, it would become a non-conforming sign, and it would be subject to the non-conforming for reasons of the original ordinance. Because it does not conform to the requirements. Technically, it's probably an illegal non-conforming sign at the present time, and that there were never any permits issued for that. And so it has no standing in the community as a sign in terms of continuing to be there. I mean, there's any intent to want to remove it, but it doesn't have any vacant standing.
There's a, according to what I've read, if there's something that's already in place, that even though it's non-conforming, it can still stay there, but it has to be maintained.
No. In order to have a non-conforming status, it has to be a legal use at the time the new regulation was adopted.
Right.
So it would not be a legal non-conforming use if it did not comply with the current code. The code that was in place when it was done. In murals may be something you would do want to revisit in an amendment.
Yes.
I think that mural was on that building long before Carol even had it. I mean, it's been there for years. So I'm not even sure which code.
It was there when I was a kid.
So how do you know what code it would have been by?
It would have been under the county code, and I don't know what they said.
I don't think there was a code.
Then it would be legal.
It's classified as an existing non-conforming, but it has no standing.
Considered a historical sign, it has significance.
Well, existing non-conforming, you'll find that in a lot of properties, boundaries, different fence lines and things.
I just don't want to have to paint over.
Well, yeah.
Well,
the QIA
in order for anything to happen with it, it would have to be an enforcement action by the town. And if the town chooses never to go out there and enforce it, then it'll be there for another 50 years.
I think if we choose not to address something that does not conform, that could lead to further questions down the line. I think we can address it, make a provision, keep our laces tied on this.
We just have to be uniform with enforcement. We can't be selective.
Exactly.
I don't know how old this is, but it probably goes back a ways, and perhaps there was no county code because. Well, I don't know how far back it goes, but if there was no code covering this, then there were no regulations in effect, and it would become a legal non-conforming use.
I don't think we were even La Paz County.
No.
It was in Yuma County.
I suggest we go forward with what we have and then come back and revisit that at some
point. We want to open this up for public comment as well, so let's go ahead and open it up for public comment, and then we'll bring it back to the council for further action. Anyone from the audience wishing to speak on this?
Carrie, I'm in town of Quartzsite. I think it's important as we visualize what we want Quartzsite to be or what it's becoming, if part of that is hanging on to some past and keeping some past, that things like that, that generations of people have noticed, particularly their customers that come off the highway twice a year for the last 40 years, to not have that there, seems like we're taking away a little bit of what Quartzsite is.
Anyone else in the audience? Seeing none, we'll close the public comment, bring it back to the council. Further questions? Corrections? Okay, this is, I believe this is an action item this week.
Can I just ask you to reread that section one, general paragraph 1A, permit required, can you reread that, make sure we have a...
Except as provided for exempt signs, it shall be unlawful for any person to construct, install, attach, place, paint, alter, or relocate any sign in the town without first obtaining a sign permit in accordance with this sign.
Great, thank you.
Everybody understand the language the way it is? This is an action item. What's your...
I believe that the caption was read as part of the introduction. You read the caption. You read the motion, which included the caption.
Yes.
But the action item included the caption, so you do not have to reread it now.
I make a motion to approve adoption, or to adopt sign code by reference Article 12 of the zoning articles as presented with the corrections proposed.
Second.
With the corrections that are made.
Corrections that are made.
I'm seeing on item 2, back in action, requested. It's listed as ordinance number 18-14. Am I looking at something incorrect here on tab 2?
That's what it was previously, yes. It's the same ordinance number as it was at the last meeting, correct?
Yeah, it should be.
So it's 18.
Okay, well, in that case, I make a motion to adopt ordinance number 18-14 as presented with the corrections made.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve ordinance number 18-14. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Under item 3, under business, Vice Mayor, Council designation of a member of the council as Vice Mayor. Each time we have an election, change members on the council, we elect a new vice mayor. So, what's your pleasure?
Does it have to be a new vice mayor, or can we nominate the current one?
There's no restriction that I'm aware of.
Well, I nominate Loretta Warner again.
And I'll second that.
Does Loretta Warner?
She's smiling. I have a motion and a second to put Loretta Warner back in as vice mayor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously.
Congratulations.
Thank you guys for...
Item 4.
Thank you all for trusting me and putting me back in that position. I appreciate your support. Thank you.
We're just going to turn up the heat now.
Do you think you were going to escape?
No.
Okay. Okay, item four, minutes. Consider approval of minutes of the town council regular meeting of November 27th, 2018. Are there any corrections to the minutes? Bruce?
Yes, ma'am. On page 221, down at the bottom, says town attorney Goodwin responded that she has found with the other town that it and is should be reversed. It says is it, it should be it is. And then on page 12 of 21, just a clarification where it talks about Councilmember Bearcat said she would like to have a caveat. The last line, I'm not sure, she, the Quartzsite Senior Center's application, I'm not sure what's supposed to be in there.
She said she thought a little more information was needed to see if it is a bucket.
Could be she said the Quartzsite Senior Center's application. Okay, that's my best guess. Those are the only corrections I have. Just saying, she thought a little more information was.
She thought a little more information, so take out said and she.
She said. So it just reads, she thought a little more information was needed. Any more corrections to the minutes? Okay, this is an action item.
I make a motion that we accept the minutes as corrected.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to accept the minutes of November 27th, 2018 as corrected. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Item five, ledger of accounts and payroll paid. Consider for approval the following series. Accounts payable 44733 through 44762, voiding 44732. Totaling $129,342.55. Checks 44773 through 44806, totaling $474,960.79. Payroll, checks 44763 through 44772, totaling $75,454.20. Grand total, $679,757.54. Anyone have any questions, concerns on any of these?
I don't know if anybody can answer it. The JSA, the landscapers, had two major payments here. I hope there's still some money in owed to them before they leave town.
I don't know about the O2, but typically when they do those kinds of projects, they withhold at least 10 to 15% for a period of time after the job is completed. So if, yeah, for, if there's any issues or problems or anything that comes up, that's kind of a typical, especially major.
They work on draws.
Right.
Right.
I do have one correction. Page 6, item 44788, it says Oakley Patrol Boots, it says Desert Boot. I think it should probably say Desert, D-E-E-S-E-R-T. It's kind of picky, I'm sorry.
What check is
it? It's 44789.
Desert boots.
Maybe they want to be desert.
Good catch.
Mummy was saying, we're paying an awful lot of money for internet service. I'm not saying we have to charge for it, but that does seem a lot. And when I came in tonight, parked right next to a guy that was on the internet, just, you know, municipal internet service. I don't know if the library could turn it on, it might upset a few people.
Well, okay, I might have made a mistake. I don't think I understood your question. That kind of is a substantive.
Because I'm gonna put that on the next agenda, so that's why I wanted to make sure. We'll talk about it next time.
Do we have a break it up?
I'm sorry.
Can you speak up?
Okay, it's really not on the agenda.
Any more questions?
Yeah, on the APS, I know this is probably out of bounds, but it seems extremely high. And I was told there's a lot of streetlights, but I want to put something on the future agenda on streetlights, so we can just let that one go for now.
Okay. Any questions on any of the checks? Any explanation? Hearing none, this is an action item.
Okay. I will move to approve the following series: accounts payable 44733 through 44762, with check 44732 being voided, totaling 129,342.55. Check numbers 4473 through 44806, totaling 474,960.79. Payroll 44763 through 44772, totaling 75,454.20, for a grand total of 679,757.54.
I second. I have a motion and a second to approve the ledger of accounts and payroll paid as presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Item 6, Park and Recreation Committee reappointment request. Consider the reappointment of Joanne Weiner to the Park and Recreation Committee. Her term expired June 1st, 2018. The new term would expire June 1st, 2020. Is Joanne here? She's not here. Anyone wishing to speak on behalf of the Park and Recreation Committee? Recommendation?
Rain will agree with me. We need more people, so, and from what I've noticed from the one meeting, she was a good part of the board, and if I was to be honest with you, if she wasn't here, we wouldn't have had a quorum that day. So she's a good part of the board. I haven't seen I look back to the minutes and I haven't really seen any problems with her being on the board. And we need more people on that board, so.
Thank you for bringing that to us. Thank you.
Greetings, Mayor and Council. Shanana Rain Goldenbear, Vice Chair of the Parks Board. It's been a wonderful time to have Joanne Weiner on the board, as she and her foundation has been working for the last 24 years on Celia's Rainbow Gardens. And it was a really good idea to bring her in. So now she's a huge part of all of the process. So I think it's a really good fit. Thank you.
Thank you. Council?
I know she's, you know, very, very dedicated, not just to Celia's garden, but she's been real active in the community. I have no problem. In fact, I consider we're lucky, fortunate.
action item for reappointment.
I will move that we accept the reappointment of Joanne Weiner to the Park and Recreation Committee. Her term expired on June 1st, 2018, and her new term will expire on June 1st, 2020.
Second. I have a motion and a second to reappoint Joanne Weiner to the Park and Recreation Committee. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Discussion of possible new town seal. Consider changing the town seal to a more clearly pronounced and colorful one, stylized the same as the current one. Item seven.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
This came about because of me. When we decided to put the town council on a trolley as an entry in the Christmas, in the holiday parade, I came over to town hall looking for a banner, which we don't really have. So the decision was made, Mark and I decided to contribute a banner to the town with the town seal on it and identifying the town council. I came in and talked to Ms. Tina, and we looked for a graphic of the town seal. The town seal graphic that we have is very small, and if you try to blow it up, yes, it got very grainy and fuzzy. So at that point, I came and got Bruce's flag, took it to the house. We took a picture of it, and Mark went, I can't work with that. So Mr. Goldberg took the seal, the current seal, and just spruced it up a bit. So that is the seal that can be now blown up, correct?
This can be blown up to virtually any size now because it's digitized and has the detail it ever had.
Now, for a legal seal on a document, would you use just the one in there?
Yeah.
Yeah, just this. Well, this is the seal. This is the banner for the Christmas parade.
Yeah. And that is the seal. It's just the only change he made was outlining.
Or put color in it.
I'd like to get a little history on the seals that we see here.
Silver camels don't really strike me. The colors, cactus and camels are silver.
Oh, on this?
Yeah.
Well, and that couldn't be used for what I was doing because it's an artistic interpretation of the seal. What I was trying to do was use the basic colors and keep it graphically the same, but make the colors sound and the graphics sound to where it can be used for purposes other than a one-inch seal.
Makes more sense with the colors.
Yeah. So it's just to clarify, not to change it any way.
And branding is becoming more and more important for communities and businesses.
So that's the difference between this.
Yes.
Original.
Much better.
Mayor? on most of our papers that we get, we have a seal. And it's got orange on it. And that seal was started before Skylar, the town manager, that, or before he became town manager. And when he became town manager, and if you look at your other seals, you'll see the seal at the top left that's kind of squashed and oval-shaped. Okay, he came up with that one, and that's what he used. And now Mark has come and made things a lot clearer, and other than the color of gold is difficult to reproduce on a copy machine, it looks clean and much easier to understand. And the next page is what it looks like when it's run through a copy machine. And to my knowledge, we have never adopted an official seal. We just used the graphics. So we've never said, this is the town seal.
Does that take an action to adopt it? What needs to be done?
What I've seen in the past, is that yes, usually the council adopts an official seal, and sometimes they get them copyrighted or trademarked. I think it's the word trademarked, so that any reuse of it would have to be with your permission. And it's a fairly simple process for them.
Is it appropriate for us to go ahead and adopt this?
Is this council action or direction?
The, what Jim had put down is direct staff to prepare a resolution. I would do the formality of a resolution so that you've got it in your records separately.
Okay. Direction to staff to prepare a resolution adopting a new town.
May I ask a question? Mark, just probably your the words, the founder, and then the dates, and the incorporated, and the dates, could those be like a dark blue or some other color to make it a little better, a little easier to read, because these tend to disappear into the background. So.
Yeah, on the original seal, they were just yellow on a white background, which made it didn't reproduce or really not diverge with anything. I outlined the letters in black so that it is readable. At most scales. If they were solid, it would be far more readable, but again, my goal wasn't to change it, it was to just make it readable. If you want to change it and adopt a changed version, we certainly do that, so you know, I can change the colors to whatever you like. But it is very difficult to read those.
There is, I have a limited amount of printing experience. This is probably inkjet printing on the original copy that we have here. What I'm getting at is if it's printed, if we spend the money and get it printed, it will come out a lot clearer.
Right. But I think the point's well taken. If those letters were blue, it matched the blue in the background, and it'd be clearly readable at any scale. So I think it's probably a good idea.
I don't have a problem with that today, but again, if we're going to, like our letterhead, if it goes out to a commercial printer, they have to have a clean copy to start with. But it will look a lot better, and then when you reproduce it with Xerox or photocopy, it'll be a lot better. You always have to have the best possible that you have. And still, even with laser printing, still printing is a better quality.
Well, the whole purpose of this exercise was to develop a high resolution digital image that can be used for printing other purposes, trying to come out clear.
Well, I agree that the color of the fountain and the incorporated darker color, like blue, to match everything else.
Whoever designed this originally with the blue and the yellow like that must have been a Boy Scout. What it appears, the colors of a Boy Scout.
There were 10.
And is there...
10 different ones.
Okay, kind of work. What I kind of like to see is the gold on the dates, blue, but then also another version of it that's a black and white version, so you don't have to convert the color to black and white, and for printing purposes.
You like grayscale?
Yeah.
So should we have them, have him or someone make the changes and bring it back and just table this until the next?
Well, there's nothing on, we wouldn't be approving it tonight, you don't have a resolution. But I was just going to draft a resolution, and someone's going to attach something to it.
I think it'd be nice to have, make sure it looks like what we think it's going to look like. I would direct staff to Mr. Goldberg, to do a rendering at the request of, the council's made the request of, in those two sections, and bring it back for the next time.
And also a resolution?
Someone want to present this?
Is call to the public, I mean, a public comment? Can I speak now?
Yes.
I was Marilyn McFay. I was there, and there were at least a dozen submissions of drawings for the original seal. The one that was chosen by the council at that time, the gentleman ended up in prison. But they paid him, and there was a copyright, to the best of my knowledge. The engraving and the seal to put on the gold awards and things were made in Yuma at Yuma Engraving. I think legally you could just call it an upgrade of the original, because you aren't changing the wording or anything else, just identifying and making it stronger, and Mark is very good at that.
Thank you.
Jared Mummy?
No, that was for the one previous.
Oh, sorry about that.
Okay, we're looking to direct staff to prepare a resolution adopting a new town seal.
That might be proven, I think, to see if it is copyrighted.
It is. When Jim gets back, I'll have him search the records, I don't know. And I'm not an intellectual property lawyer, I have one in my firm. I don't know if there's latitude to make small changes or updates. This is something I have to find out.
And there's a copyright and trademark.
Yes, and I honestly don't know if it's copyright or trademark.
I think this probably would be more of a trademark. But anyway, staff can look that up and research. But what I would like to do is have staff, Mark, come up with the modified ones, so we can take a look at that, see which one we want. With the different colors, and that way we have a little bit better idea of what we want. So that would be my recommendation.
So would we build that into the motion, saying, make the direction to staff pending citizen submission of an update?
We're just directing staff, I won't need a motion on this one.
At the next meeting, there'll be something you'll agree on to attach to the resolution.
Okay, if you're clear on that, then we'll move on to item eight. Discussion of a resolution declaring Quartzsite, Arizona as the rock capital of the world.
I
item eight, we had some historic information here on a previous resolution, a proclamation. So this, we have a proclamation, now we're wanting to make a resolution.
Would you like the information?
What's the difference between them? Do we need a resolution for a proclamation?
I'm not familiar with this item.
I am.
I'm sorry, this is Jim's, I guess, so I'm not.
They give us a list, item eight, there is a proclamation from Wes Huntley from a number of years ago. Don't see, can't read the date.
December 8th, 2009. Would you like some history on that?
Yes, please.
Shanana Rain Golden Bear, former president of Proud Neighbors of Quartzsite, which was the driving force to get this. And let's see, I believe Star was also part of this way back when we met with former town manager Alex Taft and then Mayor Wes Huntley. And we thought, that would be a great idea. What do you guys think? And so they said, we need a proclamation. Well, I had no clue how to do a proclamation. Anyhow, it was on Tuesday, December 8th, 2009, when acting Mayor Wes Huntley proclaimed Quartzsite, Arizona, the rock capital of the world during the regular council meeting of the town council. And it says, the residents of Quartzsite, Arizona are proud of our rich history of gold mining, prospecting, and the love of rock. Each year, buyers and sellers from around the world are attracted to our region for the finest gems, rocks, and minerals, and is the home of the nation's largest rock and gem club. That came from Wes Huntley. And he went on to say that the town of Quartzsite, Arizona will continue to promote the community and support these ideals and projects that will grow the distinction of our community as the rock capital of the world. A copy of the whole proclamation was here somewhere.
We have it. Okay. It has some extra lines, three extra whereases involved in the right. ones that we're reading here.
And at that time, Council Member Joe Winslow said, quote, we need to be proud of this, it's a big deal. Proud Neighbors of Quartzsite at that time invited all residents, businesses, organizations, and visitors to start claiming it in emails, letters, cards, advertising, etc., to tell the whole world what an amazing town this is. Oh, said Star Bearcat. So yes, you were, okay, you were a part of that, definitely. This was off of the Desert Messenger from Monday, December 14th, 2009, so.
Also, there's a great deal of checking to see if there was any other towns or cities or anything that claimed to be the rock capital of the world. And where this kind of originated is we were on a trip and we went to this little place out in the middle of nowhere that said the center of the world. And they had a plaque and they had some really nice little park and walls, dedication for law enforcement and so on. And it got us to thinking that Quartzsite needs to be branded. We need to have a brand for Quartzsite that describes what we're basically about, and it it's rocks. And so we brought this to the process, and it came out as the proclamation of Rock Capital of the World.
Thank you.
I, at League Cities last week, introduced myself from Quartzsite, Arizona, the Rock Capital of the World, and I was corrected from Winslow, said, you used to be. So I don't know.
Well, if Winslow is using it, then
no.
They're not using it. They just said we needed to, you know, I should check my facts.
Well, I don't understand what they're saying, because we're claiming it, whether it's true or not, doesn't matter.
I think they were just being cheeky. That's what I think.
Well, I just wonder why we're limiting it to Rock Capital of the World. We could be Rock Capital of the Universe.
Yeah.
That's undisputed.
Well, whatever you all want to do with it, we need to be branded and use it and copyright it.
And so, Susan, what process do we need to make this into a resolution? From a proclamation to a resolution.
Yeah, I'm not sure what prompted the desire for the change. Generally, a proclamation is just something issued by the mayor, and then a resolution, however, has the force of the entire council behind it. So that's probably what was behind it. So it would be pretty easy to prepare a resolution that the whole council adopted. To declare yourself the Rock Capital of the World. But you would want to, if you do that, you'd want to have a plan for how you use that.
Use it on all letterheads and any communications that the town uses.
Like something at the bottom of the page when you
have a letterhead. If businesses want to use that phrase, then we could give them permission to use it because it markets the town.
Some of you might remember the little fight between Scottsdale and Wickenburg as to who was going to be the west, most western town. And I'm not sure, I mean, I don't know why Scottsdale still wanted to be that, but Wickenburg was deciding to claim it. And as I recall, it was kind of a standoff. But it's really not a legal issue. It's just something that it would be your tool, one of your tools, to promote an aspect of the town and be something different. We can do a resolution and
we've been claiming it since 09, so we beat them out a long time ago.
Okay, we have a member of the public wishing to speak on this. Sarah, please come forward, introduce yourself.
Yes, I am Clifford Brown. I was raised here in Quartzsite. I wasn't born here, but I was here when I was 6 months old. My father was here because he had tuberculosis, but my mother started this rock thing in 1956. I was in the Air Force stationed at Yuma, and I come up every weekend and stuff. So, and for your knowledge of when it started, and it was started by Mildred Helen Cowell Parkman. And my father passed away in 38, so she remarried a prospector. But anyway, just for your information, yes, it started back in 1956.
Thank you. That's an interesting history.
Thank you.
Have a copy of that over at our museum. In the history of the food. No, I said it would be. Yes, definitely we need to get that, brother. Okay.
To me, it would be the same thing as our logo that we just been talking about. It's a marketing tool, but I think it's a very important thing to be consistent in how we market the town. Just like the town logo, the town saying, or whatever, it would help us identify Quartzsite. So I would like to direct staff to put together a resolution. And we need to research
a part of the what happens when you look at trademarks and that is that research is done to make sure that nobody else has it. And so that would be something that, that would need to be done also. It's important enough, just like our logo, it's important enough to make sure that we either trademark it or register it or copyright it so that nobody else can use it. And if they want to use it, they have to come to us to get permission.
My only hesitation on this is this is a, ends up like a vision statement. Everyone's got a different approach of what the thing should be included in it. I just wonder if this is something that can be put in our newspaper for public input on what should be in a resolution on the rock capital of the world. Is that something that we can get the public involved in? Maybe make a contest out of it, something like that. We're not getting the public involved in any of this stuff. Nice to do it.
You got an idea?
And I agree with that, Mayor. But I think we're looking at a marketing tool, not a vision statement. I think that the town of Portside, absolutely, we need to update our vision statement. But this as a marketing tool, I think, absolutely, if we can involve the public, we should.
Yeah, I agree with that. It's just my opinion that no one of us is smarter than all of us. And there may be some good ideas out there of things that could be included in this that we haven't thought of. So that was my concern. How do we move forward on this?
I'd like to have staff make the resolution and the public can come and say their piece and we can decide if we want to change the resolution at that time or keep it. The public seems to want to come at night. They don't like coming in the daytime to a lot of the meetings, and this would be a chance for them to voice what they want, and if there's enough voices, then we can relook at a different phrase and just modify that. But I think we need to move forward on this because we can stall this for years.
Well. Okay. And I think getting the public input first before we do a resolution might be the better, I mean, there's no sense having a resolution prepared if we're going to need to change it.
That's what I was wondering, if we could put it in the Desert Messenger.
My only concern would be it's like designing a camel by committee. Designing a horse by committee.
Three humps.
You get one hump or two. I'm not opposed to having public input, but I don't want to get us off track and go a different direction. If it's something that's been used for so long and there is a history and a tradition of it, back to the 1950s, we were talking about keeping our history and murals on the wall and that type of thing. If it has that kind of history and it's documented and we have witness of that, then that seems to me to be part of our history and we might want to really consider that.
Good point.
So I'm okay either way. But to be clear, we are only considering Rock Capital of the World as the town motto or the town vision.
No, it sounds like a motto. Okay. I'm thinking, why change a good thing? And if you're branding something, you've got to have something that people will remember. And they've already remembered us as the rock capital of the world. I don't know where we could go with this.
And as far as the resolution, the way it's written, that's been redone several times already. Rain's documentation is different than the one Wes Huntley had here in our packet that shows three additional changes in there already. So I don't think anything is cast in stone. Is it timely? That's, if there's nothing changed, then okay. If there's a good idea or two comes from it, then it's a timely.
I'm going to go back to what I said earlier. If I need to make a motion to have a resolution made, or have the town or have the staff prepare a resolution, I'll make a motion that we have the staff, the town staff, prepare a resolution declaring that Portside is the rock capital of the world.
I'll concur with that or second it, whichever it takes.
So are we going to consider trademarking or whatever?
Along with that would be trademarking, copywriting, whatever would go with that, yes.
Yeah, you've got all kinds of issues with that, you do that.
Okay, if you presented it as a motion, so let's go ahead and adopt it as a motion. Have a motion and
a second.
And a second to direct staff to prepare a resolution declaring Quartzsite, Arizona as the rock capital of the world. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Communications, report from the mayor on current event. This past weekend, we had the Soup and Chowder Festival and Operation Hero Comfort silent auction. And it looked to me to be very well attended. And I was there at 11 o'clock, then I was back at 2, and then back at 4 o'clock. And it was still full of people and looked to be well attended. So if you haven't attended any of the Soup and Chowder silent auctions, put it on your calendar for next year. That's well attended. Okay, reports from council.
This past week on Thursday and Friday, Councilmember Goldberg and I attended the newly elected officials training in Mesa. It was a lot of fun, but it was more importantly very informative for myself, being newly elected and then being appointed even before me, but I learned a lot there. Again, I'm not eloquent, but that's the update.
The interesting thing, and we got to talk with a lot of folks that newly elected folks from similar communities, and you know what? We're all dealing with the same issues. When it comes right down to it, we're all dealing with the same issues. And my other comment would be the holiday parade, the light parade on Saturday. The council will be on the trolley from the QIA, and everybody should be at QIA at what time did you say?
Six.
Parade starts at 7.
In their best Christmas attire.
In their best Christmas.
Warmest.
Long
whatever y'all want to do.
Well, I went to a ribbon cutting, was that yesterday, Saturday?
Yeah.
And anyway, a lot of good turnout, parking lot was full of Coyote Fresh, and they had some good sales going on. They had a big line at the meat counter, so I was pleased with that.
Okay, that concludes reports from the council. And now, as reports from the town manager, do you have anything that representing the town manager? Okay. Future agenda items.
I just want to make sure that the library internet discussion is on there.
The library internet, and it's a good discussion. I've had that with Jim. That's definitely that needs to be on there. About the water loss report that needs to get on there as a item other than just a report, because I think we need to look at exactly how the water loss was. Because when I was on the water board, we would lose as much as 2 million gallons a month. And I'd like to see where we're at, and that shows the leakage in the system and so on. I'd like to also have an audit of all the streetlights the other night, I went down some streets that had streetlights that were out. And there's some very dark spots, and there's streetlights that should belong to the town or APS that are not over the street, they're over private property. And I think that needs to be corrected. It'd be good to have an audit of the lights, and with that, I'd like to have a dark skies ordinance where you have to use a certain color of light and cast a point down, not up, because a lot of people come here to see the stars. We've got gorgeous skies.
Probably the promotion of it would take place in the future agenda.
Okay.
Make it an agenda item.
Make it an agenda item to have dark skies.
Okay.
I was just going to say you can report the streetlights on iWork on the Public Works website. That works really well.
There's more to it than that. We'll have to discuss it during that.
But you can cover any lights without maintenance issues on iWork at the Public Works.
Somebody could, but they don't.
Okay, having no further business to come before the...
Are we having a council meeting? Is this our last meeting?
I understand the one on Christmas Day has been postponed, or is the next one canceled?
We have to decide that here tonight, I believe. Is that true?
Well, it's not on the agenda. What about canceling the meeting?
The next one would be Christmas Day. We can discuss it, or we can leave it to the town manager to get together with.
Regularly scheduled after. Is there pressing matters for us to take care of?
Well, it's a matter of, is there a mandatory number of meetings? Do we need to reschedule, or can we go without it? Is there a requirement for how many meetings of the year? Okay, definitely.
I think with our workload, we shouldn't cancel it, because we have an awful lot of stuff to cover. We should have it before or after Christmas. It's just my opinion.
During that week, I'm not sure that we have anything that critical that has to be done between now and the second week of January that we can't handle in January.
I agree.
I mean, there's so much going on already with the light parade and everything else. I just think that trying to put a council meeting in the middle of all of this is going to be difficult.
And if there is, the town manager can call an emergency meeting. So I don't see a problem with it.
I would cancel the December 20th.
Let's just agree not to show up for some
reason. Okay. We'll see you back the first meeting of January. Okay, having no further business come before this council, we're hereby adjourned.